This is Advent season, and I know that it's a season we always say, Advent season, Advent season, Advent season. The question I ask you this morning, that what are you expecting? What is your expectation? This Advent, what are you expecting? All these beautiful renditions are supposed to help us reflect on why Jesus came to this world and what can it do for me personally. It's supposed to be that. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you that you love the world so much that you give us your only begotten Son, Jesus Christ, that whoever believes in him will not perish, but have everlasting life. Yes, the coming of Jesus Christ brings excitement, and it also brings anticipation, expectation. Sometimes, during the process of trying to see what expectations that we have towards your coming, we mix it up, and very soon we don't even know where we are as believers. May you help us to discern clearly what your coming should mean for us. I pray that I don't qualify to explain it, but I ask that you use me as a vessel to make it clearer to your children, your people who are excited about you and therefore will spend time to be with you so they can hear the story again. Jesus, just take control over my intellect, voice, and proclaim your word to your people in the name of the Father, the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. What is your expectation? Or what is your expectation this Advent season? Today is the second day of Advent. And the question is, what does it mean for me personally, what does it mean for you? Is it just about lighting Advent candles with the prayers that goes with it and we go home? Or to you, is it about going to the malls and shopping or shopping online? Is it about singing carols and we get excited and we go home? Is it all about giving gifts and Christmas cards and then we are happy? Is that all? Or is it about preparing our hearts to welcome Jesus Christ into the world he created a second time? Friends, if it's preparing our hearts to receive Christ into the world he created, into our hearts, what should be our attitude? What should be the way we look at Advent, that we can make it more meaningful in the world? Today, the world is making, have taken over, and to teach us how Advent should be celebrated. It's a shame. It is a shame that Christians have allowed the world to define them who they should be. I feel sorry about that. Friends, I feel very sorry. We need to pause, think about why Jesus came into the world the first time, and he promised he will come a second time. And he's going to come a second time. Just imagine if you are not ready when he comes. Friends, Advent is not in the Bible, all right? But since 5th century, Christians have designated the four Sundays before Jesus is born to prepare for his coming. And even though it's not the Bible, it's a very spiritual moment. Why? Because Jesus is coming. We just don't sit and do nothing. We need to make sure that the King of Kings is coming into the world again, that the Creator of heaven and earth is coming again, that God who dwells in an arm of light is into his world again. And how do we look at it? What should our attitude be? Suppose the President of the United States is coming to Freeport. Let me tell you, if you don't care, take care, the mayor of this city will cut you off if you are in the way. Or suppose he's coming into my house. Do you think that I will just be there, leave everything filthy and things like that? No. I'm going to do the best to welcome the president into my house. What about when the one who created you and entire universe is coming to his world again? What should our attitude be? Listen, if we never heard anything about it, then okay, fine. But if God has intentionally prepared us for this day, then it's on to us if we did nothing, you know. So, yes, since the 5th century, Christians have developed four Sundays before the Christmas day to prepare for his coming. So, what does it mean? What does Advent simply mean? It simply means coming or arrival. Okay, in the New Testament, there is a Greek word parousia. The parousia simply means coming or arrival of the Lord. And so the truth is this, that the Lord is coming to his earth again, right? Jesus is coming again. Does it hit you for you to sit up and think about Jesus and what he wants from you, what he expects from you? Or it's one of those things. How do we treat it as believers, as Christians? Are we really serious thinking about that message? Or it's as usual, it's about shopping and giving gifts and singing carols and that's it? It is a tragedy which needs to be corrected. And so the advent of the Lord is simply referring to the second coming of Christ. During the time that this Advent season was instituted, they just didn't say Advent. So these 4 Sundays or 4 weeks, it was meant to prepare for Christ Jesus to come. So when they celebrated Advent, it was very similar to the way we celebrate Lent season today. It was a season of prayer, right? It was a season of fasting. It was a season of repentance. It was a season of anticipation, anticipating that greatness is coming because Jesus is coming. Or a season of hope, a season of peace, because Christ is coming, a season of love, a season of joy, and a season of kindness. That's what it was meant to be, friends. And so I do believe that if we don't go back to the first code, we will be going with the crowd. And we think that it's okay. But it's not okay, friends. If you are a believer, it's not okay. If that's the way those who brought this tradition meant, that it was a season to reflect, to pray, to fast, to repent, then the question is this, that have you ever spent time praying about Advent or praying for transformation of your life? Have you ever gone to that point? If not, maybe time to sit, reflect, and think, and change your ways to be consistent with the expectation you have about the coming of Christ. Listen, God doesn't do anything without giving heads up. He always used his prophet to announce things that were to come, things that were to happen. And so he used Isaiah to one of the prophets he used was Isaiah. And I'm just going to use some of his prophecies. If you go to 40 verse 1 to 5, which I will just go to where I want to. A voice of one calling in the wilderness, prepare the way of the Lord, make straight in the desert a highway for our God. Every valley shall be raised up, every mountain and hill made low, and the rough ground shall become level, the rugged places a plain. There's a voice in the wilderness crying, prepare the way for the Lord. Yeah, before Jesus was born, John the Baptist was sent to prepare the way, prepare people's hearts before Christ come in. And that's what Matthew tells us in chapter 3, 1 to 12. Yes, John the Baptist came preaching in the wilderness of Judea and saying, repent, for the kingdom of God has come near. And then the prophet Isaiah just was made clear, because a voice of one calling in the wilderness prepared the way for the Lord, make straight paths for him. I do believe that if you have high expectation from the Lord and you are doing nothing, it's a mistake. It's wrong. You got to do something. And that's why John the Baptist came. Prepare, 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 prepare. Do something. Don't just be there. Don't just go shopping. Don't just sing carols. Huh? Don't just do anything just because everybody is doing it. Just begin to go back to the original code. What did this season mean for you? Because I always say, life is spiritual. Spiritual controls the physical. So if you allow the physical to dominate the spiritual, you will be going with the crowd. You will be going with the crowd. But if you pause and begin to do reflection, you begin to pray, you begin to fast, begin to make sure that you have truly repented and you have Christ in your heart, entire Advent season becomes so meaningful. Then everything we are doing becomes different to you. And you show kindness in way you have not shown, because that's what Christ represents. So God prophesied about it through Isaiah. That should happen, and it was fulfilled in Matthew, in John the Baptist. The important things John brought to us that later on I would want you to pay attention. Okay, sometimes people have given the impression that, oh, the coming of the Lord is all joyful, all happiness, all peace, all everything. Of course, that is what Christ represents. Okay, but let me tell you, it's not going to be as simple as you think it should be. Because the prophets made it clear, the day of the Lord, and who can stand? You know, and if you do it right, let me tell you something that Isaiah wrote again in 11, 5 to 9. Yet it's not yet going to happen now, but when he comes, he said he will strike the earth with the rod of his mouth, with the breath of his lips, he will slay the wicked. Okay, I didn't say that. When Christ come again, he will strike the earth with the rod of his mouth, with the breath of his lips, he will slay the wicked. He said righteousness will be his belt, and faithfulness the sash around his waist. And this is what I love most. The wolf will live with the lamb. Can you believe that? A wolf lying side by side with the lamb. Can you imagine a time like that? That can happen? I don't know. He said the leopard will lie down with the goat. Really? I look at the jungle and I thank God that I'm not an animal. He created me a human being. Because in the jungle, if you wrap, you wake up, you add that could be part of you, or you can still keep. Because if you get to the one which is stronger than you, your day has come to an end. You will be eaten by the one who is stronger than you, all right? And God is telling here that a day is coming, a leopard is going to lie down with the goat. The calf and the lion, and they're yelling together, and a little child will lead them. I will never try that one, letting a little child lead a lion. Can you think about that? And the cow will feed with the bear. Oh, their young will lie down together. And the lion will eat straw like the ox. Really? I one time read in somebody's poster, if even the economy in the jungle got tough, the lion has promised itself it will never eat grass. It will never eat grass. But now we are hearing that it will now compromise and start eating grass. Huh? And the infant will play near the cobra's den. Really? Listen, in Africa here, you can't do that. If you see a cobra, you kill it. You don't need no permission. You kill it before it kills anybody. But here, you be careful how you kill any insect or any animal. They will come after you. All right. Yeah. And the young child will put its hand into the viper's nest. They will neither harm nor destroy on all my holy mountain. You see, it's true that this is figurative language, but it's also a picture of when Christ, how things will be when Christ's reign begins. And would you want to be part, or you don't want to be part? And if you want to be part, where is your heart? What preparation are you making? Because when that time comes, it will be great for me to go and put my hand in the lion's mouth. Oh, let me feel your mouth here. And the lion is not supposed to bite me, right? And so everything is going to be so peaceful. So peaceful. And that is what every human being is looking for. But as long as Christ hasn't come again the second time, things are going to be rough. It's going to be difficult. It's going to be hard. But it will never be harder for those who have put their faith and trust in the Lord. Let me tell you, I've seen two different people, those who trust the Lord, how they handle pressure and the problems and the challenges in the world. And I've seen those who don't have Christ. When the problems and the challenges roll, you know where they go to? They go more to the liquor store and buy more liquor, because they can't handle them. They can't. And they drink until now, sooner or later, they realize there is nothing in the world and they don't know how to change. And they are locked up there. Thank God that you have Jesus with you. Thank God you have Jesus. Because no matter how hard it is, you can reach out to your pastor for support. You can pray yourself. You can go down on your knees. You can tell Jesus. And so, friends, the coming of Jesus has high expectation, but we also have to have high preparation, not low one. because a lot of goodies are in the baggage, in his bag. And let me tell you, it is something that you don't want to be left out. You don't want to. Because no matter what it is, there is a warning. There is a warning. If you read Matthew chapter 3, 11 to 12, let me read it to you so that if you are preparing, you prepare well. All right? If you are for Christ, be for Christ well. No half full. And if you want to be in the world, all right, have a nice day, boost yourself, do whatever you want to do. That's also okay. But when the time comes, there will be consequences, friends. We have made ourselves to believe that everything is going to be peaceful. There is a lyric in some of the traditional songs we sang in Akan, Ghana, that literally says that he's not going to come back a second time like a baby in a manger. He is going to come back as a lion. Okay, fierce lion. That's why the prophets all were warning that that day of the Lord, that great day of the Lord, who can stand? Believe that, you know, the very first coming, when we talk about the parousia or the arrival, second arrival, is referring to both the first coming of Christ and the second coming of Christ. We all know the first coming of Christ has come. Jesus was born in a manger. So as we celebrate his birth, we have one eye towards his second coming. That is why we need to prepare, because it can happen now. It is a COVID-19 that taught me that, hey, I didn't know the world would change drastically like that. When they told us, close churches, close them, close them. We closed them. And I remember those days when we finished the very first church, and then a woman with a worker managed to enter the place where I had the service. I had the one technician who beamed it through Facebook and others to the church at home. And then my musician and a few people were there. He came in and he told me, you, pastor, you are going to answer to God for closing the church. Where do you want us to go? All of you churches you close, where do you want me to go? I'm standing and I'm laughing. The governor said close, my bishop said close, now I'm the one to be blamed. Huh? But that was the time, or the first time, I realized that this world can change unannounced. It can change. And what preparation are you making? That if that change comes, where will you stand? You realize it was too late. I remember those days, I thought that I could, that Sunday could have been 15th. When they come, I was going to prepare them that suppose something happens. What are we going to start do to hold on? That Sunday never came. By the Wednesday, the bishop said, close. And I had to close. Friends, that is what how the coming of the Lord should come. They asked, they praised Jesus. Tell us when. He said, I don't know. Only one person, only God knows. And it is like God is going to come like the thief, right? He is going to come like the thief. If the household owner knew when the thief is coming, he'll get his AK-47, right? To shoot anybody who comes the way. But you think that thieves are not smart? How do they get into a place they are not sure they can overpower? It's only, as I knew, I heard it in Nigeria, there are some, when the armed robbers come around, they have their arms around the place, they will cordon the place, they will put on a loudspeaker, and they are announced, Please put all your jewelry, all the money you have in the house on the table, on the center table, and close your doors, go back to sleep. Don't make a mistake by not opening your door. It's a recipe for death. They'll kill you. So if you want to comply, you open your door, bring all your money, your jewels on the table, they take and they go peacefully. And make sure you don't look at their face to see that you can recognize anybody. That one too, you will die. Those are different. This one, there will be no announcement. Arrival will come. So what preparation are you making? Because it said here, I tell you the truth. Where is it? I tell you that out of these stone, oh my goodness. He said, the axe is already at the root of the trees. And every tree that does not produce good fruit will be cut down. I didn't say that. Any tree that does not produce good fruit will be cut down. Oh, don't make the assumption that, oh, everything is going to be peaceful. Yeah, it will be peaceful for those who truly prepare their hearts to receive Christ. But it's going to be rough time for those who were not obedient and were disobedient and therefore never have the chance to change their hearts. Friends, Advent season is a very important season for deep reflection. And so the question that I would want to ask again, what is your expectation? How are you preparing? All I would tell you is to sit down quietly, even today, tomorrow. Just imagine the best you want if Christ comes. Both physically, spiritually. We still live in the world. Therefore, we have to live until we exit into the next world. So first of all, think about what you need in this world. If you want to be closer to Christ, just surrender your life, invite Christ, and change your attitude. Okay, make sure that you live your life in such a way that any obstacle in the way, any sin in the way, any envy in your heart, any bitterness in your heart, any unforgiving attitude in your heart, let go. Let go. Let go. And let in God, let in the Holy Spirit. Because if you keep these things in your heart, angry at somebody, and you want Christ to come in, you are making a huge mistake. Christ sees it, he's not coming. It reminds me that, listen, I love people who have dogs. I love them because they have double protection. But if I'm coming to your house and I see a dog, I'm not coming there again. I'm not coming. You better change the dog because I don't want to be bitten by a dog. Even though they tell me, oh, this one is friendly, I still have so much fear for dogs that I'm nervous, I'm shaking, I can't even think. I don't understand. So people try to. But, you know, it makes me so uncomfortable. And same way, you think Jesus is going to see sin and then walk in, oh, hello, hello, Ebenezer, hello, I don't worry about it. No, that's not the way it goes. Once he sees it, that's it. And that's why, friends, it's not complicated, it's not hard. But don't let us be defined by the world. The world is trying to teach us what to do. We have to teach them what to do. Okay. And so if spiritually you prepare yourself to let this go, and even if it's hard, ask God for grace and let go and let the Holy Spirit take control. And let there be, once the Holy Spirit take control, even if you have one coat and you realize your situation is better than somebody, when you give it with joy. If you are giving gifts, you have given them with joy, with happiness, coming out of a true heart, praying that anybody who receives your gift is blessed. Praying that it's going to do a wonderful thing to whoever gets your card or your thing. It's the moment to pray for them. You just don't do it. You don't just give out so many things. Pray for them. Start from the spiritual perspective. Change somebody's life. You never know. If you come to the Lord first, understand how it means, and then you reach out, how you're going to change somebody. So friends, all that we are saying is this, that Advent season is a time of a great expectation, but how are you preparing to expect the best of the from the Lord? So once you are in the season, if you are sick, yes, ask God to heal you. It's part of the blessings we are expecting. Yes, we are expecting to bring people hope, love, joy, and everything, but let it begin from the spiritual perspective. You know, friends, I just want you to make things simple for yourself. Don't make things too complicated for yourself. Advent is a great season, season of great expectation, but don't do it like everybody does it. Let Christ come in first to show you the way so that you can bring a lot of hope to the world. In the name of the Father, the Son, and of the Holy Ghost. Amen.